In this lecture, we are going to cover the pharmacology of immunosuppressants, so let's get right into it. The immune system is a complex network of cells and proteins that work together to defend the body against substances it sees as harmful or foreign. Now, the human immune system has two levels of immunity, innate and adaptive. The innate immunity is non-specific and fast-acting, and serves as the primary line of protection against pathogen invasion. Numerous cells are involved in the innate immune response, including natural killer cells, mast cells, and granulocytes, as well as the phagocytic cells, such as macrophages, dendritic cells, and monocytes, that utilize phagocytosis and are equipped with receptors which recognize a variety of microbial products known as antigens, resulting in activation of the slower-acting, but more specific, adaptive immune system. Now, the adaptive immune system consists of highly specialized systemic cells and processes that are separated into two main components, the humoral and cellular. The humoral immunity is mediated by activated B cells that produce and secrete antibodies against a specific antigen. On the other hand, the cellular immunity is mediated by T lymphocytes, also called T cells. Now, T cells circulate throughout the body until they recognize a specific antigen they are programmed for, on the surface of antigen-presenting cells such as dendritic cells. The T cell receptor on both CD4-positive helper T cells and CD8-positive cytotoxic T cells binds to the antigen as it is held in a structure called the major histocompatibility complex, MHC for short, in order to discriminate foreign from self-antigens and initiate adaptive immune responses. This sets off a signaling cascade that allows T cells to replicate, differentiate, and secrete signaling proteins called cytokines, which in turn activate more cells of the immune system. Now, depending on the type of T cell, either the coreceptor CD8 or CD4 binds to the MHC molecule. The signal transduction is then carried through CD3 that is physically associated with a T cell receptor. However, this initial signal is not sufficient for T cell activation, therefore a secondary signal is required. This secondary signal, also referred to as costimulation, occurs when CD28 receptor expressed on T cells binds CD80 and CD86 molecules that are expressed on antigen-presenting cells, thereby triggering a calcium-mediated signaling cascade. Specifically, a rise in intracellular calcium levels leads to a stepwise activation of the phosphatase calcineurin, an enzyme that dephosphorylates nuclear factor of activated T cells, NFAT for short, which in turn allows it to translocate from the cytoplasm into the nucleus. Inside the nucleus, NFAT proteins bind DNA target sequences in cooperation with partnering transcription factors, leading to activation of genes encoding cytokines, one of which is a major growth factor called interleukin-2, IL-2 for short. Now, generated interleukin-2 binds to the interleukin-2 receptors on the surface of T cells, activating a signaling protein called the mammalian target of rapamycin, mTOR for short, thereby allowing the cell to progress through the cell cycle, promoting cell proliferation of antigen-primed T cells, which subsequently produce more interleukin-2, as well as other pro-inflammatory cytokines activating natural killer cells, macrophages, and cytotoxic T cells. Alright, so the immune system is critical to survival in an environment full of pathogenic microbes. However, this vital system is not always protective, as deregulation of immune responses can lead to chronic inflammatory diseases such as autoimmunity or cancer. Moreover, the immune system serves as a barrier for the transplantation of certain beneficial organs and tissues. Therefore, a continuous use of immunosuppressive drugs is the standard of care for managing autoimmunity and transplant rejection. Now, immunosuppressive drug therapy usually consists of two or more agents with different mechanisms of action that disrupt various levels of T cell activation. So let's discuss these one by one, starting with calcineurin inhibitors. Drugs in this group work by binding to intracellular proteins called immunophilins. Immunophilins consist of two protein families, known as cyclophilins and FK-binding proteins, and are the major receptors for the immunosuppressive drugs, cyclosporin and tacrolimus, respectively. These complexes then bind to and inhibit calcineurin, thereby preventing nuclear factor of activated T cells from moving to the nucleus, which ultimately impairs transcription of the genes encoding interleukin-2 that is necessary for activation of T cells. Alright, moving on to the next group of immunosuppressants, that is costimulation blockers. Drugs in this group include belatacept and abatacept, which work by selectively binding to CD80 and CD86 on antigen-presenting cells, thereby blocking interaction with CD28 on T cells. This in turn prevents complete T cell activation, reduces T cell proliferation, and interleukin-2 production. That being said, it's important to remember here that belatacept was designed to bind to CD80 and CD86 more strongly than abatacept, and thus has been shown to be more effective in the immunosuppression necessary for transplant rejection. Now moving on to our third group of immunosuppressants, that is mTOR inhibitors. Drugs in this group include sirolimus, also known as rapamycin, and everolimus, which work by binding to the same intracellular FK binding protein as tacrolimus. However, instead of forming a complex with calcineurin, sirolimus and everolimus subsequently bind to mTOR, thereby inhibiting its activity. This ultimately leads to slowing or arrest of cell cycle progression, as well as inhibition of the cellular response to interleukin-2. Alright, moving on to the next class of drugs, that is immunosuppressive antimetabolites. The two most commonly used agents in this class are azathioprine and mycophenolate mofetil, which have similar but unique mechanism of action. So the first one, azathioprine, is first activated to become 6-mercaptopurin, 6-MP for short, which is then further metabolized to form purine analogs that mimic the structure of a building block of DNA. These false purines in turn can disrupt the novel pathway of purine synthesis, as well as become incorporated into DNA and RNA, thus terminating their synthesis, ultimately inhibiting cellular proliferation. Now, in contrast, the second agent, mycophenolate mofetil, works by inhibiting inosine monophosphate dehydrogenase, IMPDH for short, a key enzyme in purine synthesis, which is involved in the production of guanosine nucleotides. As a result, DNA synthesis, which requires guanosine triphosphate, does not occur and cell proliferation is inhibited. However, unlike azathioprine, mycophenolate is not incorporated into DNA and does not induce chromosome breaks. Now, another class of drugs that is often used for immunosuppression in both transplantation and various autoimmune disorders is corticosteroids. Drugs that belong to this class include prednisone, prednisolone, and methylprednisolone. So the effects of corticosteroids are diverse and are likely controlled by several mechanisms. One mechanism by which corticosteroids induce immunosuppression is through regulation of the T-cell responses. Acting directly on T-cells, corticosteroids mediate their effects by binding to the intracellular glucocorticoid receptor, resulting in translocation of the complex to the nucleus and subsequent inhibition of key transcription factors, such as nuclear factor kappa B and activator protein 1, which ultimately alters gene transcription and represses pro-inflammatory genes. In addition to this, corticosteroids exert non-genomic actions by causing rapid dissociation of a T-cell receptor-associated protein complexes, resulting in impaired receptor signaling and T-cell activation. Finally, moving on to our last class of immunosuppressants, that is antibodies. Now, although many different antibody products exist, for the purpose of this lecture, we are going to focus here only on the two that are most commonly used to prevent transplant rejection. The first such product is anti-thymocyte globulins, which consists of polyclonal antibodies that bind to a wide variety of proteins on the surface of T cells, leading to cell death via complement-mediated cytotoxicity or apoptosis. The second antibody product commonly used in transplant is basiliximab, which is a monoclonal antibody that binds to interleukin-2 receptor with similar affinity as interleukin-2, thereby effectively competing with interleukin-2 and subsequently inhibiting interleukin-2-driven T-cell proliferation. And with that, I wanted to thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video, and as always, stay tuned for more.